Hi, I'm Michael Vallandigham, pastor of Del Norte Baptist Church, and this is the recap of Sunday's message. My favorite dessert in all the world is my grandmother's banana pudding. She makes it completely from scratch. It's rich and creamy. Oh, it's so good. But the last thing that I would ever want her to do is to try to make her pudding sugar-free. I mean, even if it would taste good, there's no way that something that is sugar-free could ever satisfy. Many of us are looking at all the wrong things in our lives to satisfy us. And so when things go tough and things are getting hard and we go through times like COVID-19, it crushes us because we are trying to get our satisfaction from the things of the world. James is showing us here in James chapter 1, starting in verse 9, four issues that sabotage our life and keep us from having the joy that he has told us earlier in this chapter that he's wanting us to have when we go through difficult times. The first issue is pride. In James 1, 9, he says, "Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation and the rich in his humiliation." When we begin to compare ourselves to other people, it drains the joy from our life, keeps us from having a fulfilled life. Either we think that we're better than other people, or we think that we deserve what other people have. Either way, it causes us to look outside of God for the things that bring fulfillment in our life. Jesus in the early church shook up the social order. In Matthew 5:3, he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Blessed meaning fulfilled and having what we need to bring joy in our life comes when we humble ourselves, when we are poor in spirit. Humility is the key ingredient actually in all of the Sermon on the Mount. And so he is calling us to be people that humble ourselves. Pride gets in the way of our joy, and thinking we're better than others causes us to lose that joy completely. We need to have the attitude that Jesus talks about in the parable, as in Luke chapter 18, when he talks about the two that went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee who went and just boasted of how good he was and how he was glad he wasn't like other sinners. But the tax collector, who knew he was a sinner, went into the corner and humbled himself and wouldn't even look up to heaven because he realized where he was. And he ends that by saying, "Everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted." You want to have a fulfilled life? Humble yourself. The second area that sabotages us is trust. What are we trusting in? In James 1:9, he says, "The lowly brother boasts in his exaltation." What you boast in are the things that you take pride in and the things that you trust. In Proverbs 18:11, it says, "A rich man's wealth is his strong city, and like a high wall in his imagination." So it is his wealth and the physical things that can set this imaginary pride, this imaginary fulfillment that makes us think that we have it figured out. But those things are always going to let us down. In Psalm 20, verse 7, it says, "Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God." When we go through a time of like COVID-19 or whatever difficulties are going on in your life, if you put your trust in the things of this world, it's going to let you down. When you trust government, when you trust scientists, when you trust other people, schools, whatever it is, all those things will let you down. They're not going to fulfill, but your fulfillment is found in God. The third area that sabotages is our time. And what I mean by that is the think that we have a long time here on this earth. He tells us in verse 10, "Because like a flower of grass, he will pass away." A couple weeks ago, it rained a whole lot in Mountain Air where we're staying, and it caused the desert just to come alive. Flowers just came up everywhere, beautiful flowers, and the grass turned green, and that which was dead just came alive. But here, just a couple weeks later, as it continues to get hotter, and now the storms we're getting are just dust storms, and those same flowers that turned out so pretty have already, just in a few weeks, began to completely shrivel up and fade away. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8, it says, "The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever." When we put our faith and our trust in the Word of God, it gives us the foundation that we need to go through all the trials and difficulties that come in this world. And the fourth area that sabotages us is in our plans. What kind of plans are we making? He says, "For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass, its flowers fall, and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits." His pursuits, those plans that he has made, our plans are going to fade away when our plans are physical plans. Our worldly pursuits are temporary. See, we're being called here in James, in these first verses of this chapter, to be those who persevere. It's what's going to bring joy, is the understanding that we're going to persevere through these trials. And our ability to persevere through difficult days is dependent upon what we are investing in. So what are you investing in your life? Are you spending your time in the spiritual things or the physical things? Are you praying? Are you studying God's Word? Are you telling others about Christ? Are you doing those spiritual disciplines like fasting? Those spiritual things are going to bring joy and fulfillment to your life. And so he started in James 1, verse 2. He says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness or perseverance." And so we can consider it joy because of what he's going to do through it. And so what are our plans? Are our plans the things that are physical? Or are our plans the things that are spiritual? And we can consider it joy when we are not letting the things of this world get in the way of who we are and the fulfillment that we have in Christ. So where are you looking for fulfillment during this time? Because the only way that we can have a fulfilled life is to go with the One and do things the way our Creator, who created us, tells us. He's the only one that can fulfill us. And so I want to encourage you, find a relationship with God. He is pursuing you. He loves you. He cares for you. He knows exactly what you need. You pursue Him, and you're going to find fulfillment in a way that you could only have imagined. God bless you. Have a great day.